Probing Security. It's co-authored by Claude Carlet, Emmanuel Proof, Mathieu Rivin, and Thomas Roche.
Thank you for the introduction. So yeah, I'm going to present you joint work with Claude Carlet, Mathieu Rivin, and Thomas Roche, entitled Algebraic Decomposition for Probing Security. So first, let us make things concrete. And let us assume that we have implemented the AES SBox processing on an 8-bit architecture, for instance, an 8051 architecture. And during the processing of this SBox on plain text bytes X with a key byte K equal to 1, we measure the power consumption. So in X axis, here you have the time of the processing. Then you have the value of the electromagnetic emanation during this processing, and you have the density in the z-axis. So this is what we measured. This is the distribution of the electromagnetic emanation during the processing of this value when x ranges over the byte values. So this is what we measured for k equal to 1. And if we do the same for k equal to 2, we see that the distribution of the electromagnetic emanations is different. And this is the same for k equal to 3 and for k equal to 4. And we can do that for all the values of the byte. And we will see that the distribution of the electromagnetic emanation during the processing is different. And this is exactly this kind of difference we are going to use in order to discriminate the key bytes and to recover the value of the key byte which is manipulated by the device. Okay. The main observation, hence, is that the efficiency of such an attack, which will try to exploit this information leakage, depends on the amount of noise in the measurement. Concretely, if we model the leakage as a sum of an unknown function applied to the manipulated data Z plus a Gaussian noise, then we see that what makes the attack efficient or inefficient is the amount of noise, or if the noise is Gaussian, the standard deviation of the noise in the measurement. So based on this remark, we have a quite natural strategy to defeat such an attack, which is to increase the noise. Or, in other words, to decrease the signal-to-noise ratio. For that, we have two straightforward solutions. First, the first solution is to increase the standard deviation of the noise in the measurement. For instance, concretely, by adding white noise during the processing. When you are going to process, for instance, the AES box, you're going to make some electronic noise in order to hide the sensitive signal. Another solution is to force the adversary to himself decrease the signal-to-noise ratio. And for that purpose, a nice idea is to split the data into different shares. For instance, here are D shares, Z1, Z2, and ZD. And instead of applying the processing directly to Z, you're going to apply the processing to all the shares of Z, and then to recombine those processings in a clever way in order to find a sharing of your processing on Z. So if you share the data Z into D shares, and you manipulate those shares at different times, then we can model the leakage as D different leakages, L1, L2, LD. And because all those shares, all those information are needed to rebuild Z, the adversary will need to combine all those leakages all together in order to recover information on Z. And then he's gonna multiply. The intuition is that he's gonna multiply different noise altogether, and then to decrease the signal to noise ratio. Okay. So now that we know that we have a good strategy to decrease the signal to noise ratio, we want to define a secure implementation based on secret sharing techniques. The first idea related to this was proposed by Goubin and Patarin in 99 and at the same time by Shari, Jutla, Rao, and Rouadji in 99 in a crypto paper. The soundness of this approach, in a more formal way, is that if you split a bit into D, sorry, if you split a bit into D plus one shares and you manipulate those bits at D plus one different times, then the number of leakage samples you need to distinguish the tuple, the d plus one tuple of leakage related to the sharing of zero from the d plus one tuple of leakages related to the sharing of one is lower bounded by sigma to the power d, where d is a number of, where d is d plus one is the number of shares, and sigma is the noise standard deviation. Okay, this formal intuition has been generalized, and to define some model in which you can prove the security of a scheme. So, to prove the security of a scheme based on sharing techniques, we usually use what we call the probing adversary model, which has been introduced by Ishari, Sai, Wagner in 2003. So, this model assumes that, which is quite classical, that only computation leaks, which is an assumption introduced in a paper by Mikali and Raisin in 2004 at TCC. And so the idea is that if you can show that no d tuple of intermediate results depend on a secret parameter, then you get this lower bound. So you can show that you will be able to prove that the number of leakage samples needed to distinguish to discriminate, to apply an attack by discrimination is lower bounded by this, and you can also show that if you have this lower bound, then the amount of sensitive information leaking on the data which has been previously shared is lower bounded by sigma two times d. The issue with that model is that the proofs are difficult. And actually, they only exist for very simple schemes. So we know, as I'm going to show you, we know how to apply a linear processing to something which has been linearly shared. We also know how to process the multiplications on two data which have been additively shared, and we know how to prove that the scheme is secure in the probing model. But for more complex schemes, we don't have or we have very complex proofs. What I can say also is that recently automatic tools have been introduced, which can be used to help to get proofs for schemes in the probing model. Okay, so the problematic when you want to apply a function on something which has been shared is the following one, and you want to get security in the probing model, in the disorder probing model, is that for any function f and any security order d, you want to define evaluation methods that will build a d-sharing of the output fx from a d-sharing of the input x. And you want to define the scheme such that no d-tuple of intermediate results during the processing is depends on x or on fx. So this problematic is related to secure multiparty computation, circuit processing in presence of leakage, also related to efficient polynomial evaluation. And the data sharing itself and the issue of processing something on data which have been shared is related to polynomial sharing, issues related to polynomial sharing or processing when error correcting codes are used to share the data. But here we're just going to use the additive sharing. So the additive sharing I already showed you. So as I told you, we know how to process a linear function on something which has been shared additively. It's very simple. So you have the d plus 1 shares of x, and you want to apply L. You want to securely process L on x. You want to deduce a sharing of L of L x from a sharing of x. It's simple. You just apply L to all the shares of x, and you get the d plus 1 shares of Lx. Okay, for the multiplication, it's quite simple also. You have d plus 1 shares of x, d plus 1 shares of y. So you first process all the products xy times yj, and then you have to define a way how to securely process this sum, which is simply the sum of all the products of xi by the shares of y. And then you will have one share for each xy, so d plus 1 shares in total, and you will have a sharing of the product. And so this is a very simple way how to present the sharing of the multiplication, but you have a smart scheme proposed by Ishai Sahai Wagner, which do that by reducing the amount of randomness needed to get the security. Okay, so you know, we know how to securely process securely apply a linear function on something which has been shared and deduce from it a sharing of the output. We know how to securely process a multiplication, so basically we know how to process any polynomial, which can be split into linear processing and multiplications. So if you have to securely process an S-box S from F2 to the N to F2 to the M, you just have to represent it to have the algebraic normal decomposition of the polynomial. And then to evaluate this in a secure way, you just will have to secure the processing of additions, squaring, but the squaring is linear, the squaring over F2 is linear for the bitwise addition, so it's okay, it's a linear processing, and you will have to process scalar products, which is also linear. So for all the schemes, you will apply a secure, for all those processings, you will apply a secure processing, which has a complexity, linear complexity in the security order D. Only for the what we call the nonlinear multiplications, meaning the multiplications which are not square, you will need the scheme with complexity quadratic in the order D. So it gives you a game to play, which is you have a function f to process, and you will try to find splitting a decomposition of the function f into processings, into a sequence of operations, which minimizes the number of nonlinear multiplication. So this is the game we're going to play, or which has been played in several papers. I give you a function, a polynomial, and you try to find a decomposition of the processing which minimizes the number of nonlinear multiplication. So for monomials, it amounts to look for a short two addition chain for the exponentiation. And for polynomials, in fact, you can apply some previous works which have been done by Knut and Eve, so in 97. But we also proposed in paper in 2012 method based on the processing of cyclotomic lattices. And recently, Coron, Roy, and Vivek proposed a method I'm going to present in the coming slides. So this is the most efficient method we know today. So the idea is, so you start from the algebraic expression of the polynomial of the S-box viewed as a polynomial. And you take all the non-zero coefficients of the monomials in this expression, and you build S cyclotomic classes CI, so that the set of all the exponentiations here is included in the sum of the union of the cyclotomic classes plus itself. Okay, what is the idea of using cyclotomic classes? The idea is that if you succeeded to get a mono, an exponentiation, so if you process an exponentiation of one element in a cyclotomic class, then only by processing linear operations, you will succeed to recover all the exponentiation in this cyclotomic class. So you just pay for one exponentiation per cyclotomic class, and all the other powers are for free if you assume that linear processing is for free, which is the implicit assumption. So now that you have the union of cyclotomic classes, you define all the set of all the polynomials you can build by only keeping taking monomials with powers in C. Okay, this is the first step. Then you fix T polynomials in P. So you fix or you randomly select T polynomials in P, in the ideal P, and you search for T plus one polynomials PI, so that the function you want to evaluate S can be split into this sum of products. Okay, so this is a heuristic approach. The number what we know is that the number of nonlinear multiplications n is exactly s, so the one multiplication for each cyclotomic class. Then t, which is the t multiplication there. So the number of nonlinear multiplication for each s is lower bounded by this. And what is shown in the paper of Coron, Roy, Vivek is that the lower bound is always achieved. So from a linear algebra point of view, the Coron and Roy Vivek method amount to solve this linear system, and where the unknown are simply the coefficients of the t plus one polynomials pi. So you have then t plus one times n times the number of elements in the union of cyclotomic classes unknowns, and 2 to the n equations, which gives you a lower necessary condition. And in practice, once again, the condition was sufficient. So with Coron, Roy, Vivek method, we have a complexity which is 2 to the n over 2 over n times d square operation, so the number of non-linear multiplications. And in practice, you see that in the worst case, to evaluate a polynomial from F2 to D8 into F2 to D8, you need only 10 non-linear multiplications. For n equal to 6, you need, in the worst case, 5 non-linear multiplications. What is shown in the paper of Coron, Roy, Vivek is that for the DES S boxes, you have a decomposition with only 4 nonlinear multiplications, which is quite a nice result. Okay, so in our paper, we started by generalizing the Coron and Roy Vivek method. So, in fact, state-of-the-art methods, split processing into linear multiplications and into linear functions and multiplications. And then they try to minimize the multiplications. Here we propose to split the processing into functions of low algebraic degree. So we extend the nonlinear multiplication to low algebraic degree. So this approach has links with the threshold implementation issues. Before presenting the methods, I just recall that the algebraic degree of a polynomial is the greatest Hamming weight of the power of its monomials. So just to illustrate, the degree of a polynomial over GF 2 to the n is bounded above by 2 to the n, whereas the algebraic degree is bounded above by n. So just to make things clear. And the new problematic, so which is targeted in the paper, is to split the evaluation of a function f defined over gf2 to the n into the smallest number of functions of algebraic degree s, strictly lower than n, and less smaller than n. The implicit assumption is that we have efficient methods for degree s functions. Okay, so how do we extend the Kohn-Roy-Vivek approach? So instead of building a set of a union of cyclotomic classes, we first randomly generate R degree S polynomials Fi, and then we derive new polynomials Gi just by composing the functions Fi one after one. Once we have done that, we randomly generate T polynomials, Qi, so that they can be seen as the sum of linearized polynomials on the Gi polynomials. Okay, and now, the counterpart of Kohn-Roy-Vivek approach is to find T polynomials Pi of algebraic degree S. And also R plus 1 generalized polynomials Li, so that the splitting of the polynomial S can be, is this one. And so if you have a look on this formula, you see that we only processed degree S polynomials. So if we assume that we have efficient methods to evaluate such polynomials, then we have an efficient decomposition of the processing of S. So we also can rewrite problem as solving a linear polynomials a linear system like that. We also have a necessary condition. Unfortunately, in practice, we didn't achieve the lower bound, but we succeeded in having some good decomposition of some worst case good decomposition of polynomials, for instance for n equal to 8, if we split the processing into quadratic functions, into processing of quadratic functions, then we can process any polynomial into f2 to the 8 with only 11 evaluation of quadratic functions, and if we use cubic functions, then we have only to process 4 cubic functions in the worst case. Okay, so I told you that we need to have efficient methods to evaluate degree S function in order to apply this approach. So I will not have time to present the two approaches, but I can present one of the approaches we give in the paper. So the basic idea is that if you illustrate for the case of quadratic function f, so function f of algebraic degree 2, is that if you evaluate a quadratic function over a vector space of dimension 3, at most 3, then the sum of the values taken by f in this vector space equals 0. So you have this equality, so f of x equals this one. And all the elements in this sum give you a sharing of the output, fx. So here you have seven elements, so you have a sharing of fx into seven shares. And it can be shown that you need two elements in this sum to get information on x or f of x. If you want to increase the security order, you just have to split ei here into three shares, and then you will have exactly the same equality, except that you replace ei by the sum of its three shares, and you will have a sharing of fx into seven shares, but with security order 3. And we can extend the idea at willing for any polynomial and for any security order. Okay, we present in the paper a second strategy to evaluate degree S function, which is efficient if S is small. So I will not have time to present it, but it can be seen in the paper. What we do is better than the set of the art if you want to evaluate a quadratic function. It is better than the set of the art if you want to evaluate cubic function for with security orders equal to 2 or 3. Yeah, and it is better than the set of the art functions for small dimension, n equal to 4 and n equal to 8. Whereas if the ratio between the cost of addition and the cost of multiplication is for n equal to 8, is lower bounded by 5. So to sum up, to conclude, we extended in the paper the approach presented by Coron Revivec to split polynomial evaluation into processing for polynomial of the algebraic degree upper bounded by S. So further research could be, for instance, to improve the method and to find other ones, maybe to get lower bounds or to show that the lower bounds we have are tight.